Harper Audio presents Creative Quests by Questlove with Ben Greenman. This is Questlove, obviously. To my father, my first mentor, thank you for teaching me how to be creative, how to be focused, how to be resilient, how to be. Introduction. Decades into my career with many albums and songs under my belt, I still don't know if I'm truly creative. Most days I spend more time absorbing the creative work around me than actually creating myself. At times I feel like I'm way better a student than I am a teacher or a maker. The most creative thing I did today, for example, was waking up and texting Jimmy Jam about an obscure B-side from 1987. But this isn't a bad thing. I feel like my life is complete because I'm only a text away from a lot of the artists in my childhood record collection. That leaves me almost fulfilled as if I created the work myself. That's how many days go. I wake up, I engage with creative work, I don't create anything myself. Sometimes I think I'm restrained by information, that I'm too focused on the finer points of things, too detail-minded, unable to free myself from the hold of other people's work. Is it more important for me to make a song that impacts the world, or do I feel satisfied learning about someone else's songs, or books, or movies? Other days, though, I create plenty. I make albums, or participate in comedy skits, or learn how to make housewares, or write books. So, am I creative? Can I teach other people to harness their own creative energies and to get past some of their own creative anxieties? This book is a way to resolve these questions. And it's also a way to leave these questions unresolved. I will explore my creative process by examining the creative processes of people I know, who are already committed artists, whether musicians or chefs, or comedians or directors. I will play good student to their good teacher, and I will try to understand the ways they feed my own creativity. I will also tell stories from my own life. These stories are not always new, but in the retelling, they also serve a different purpose. When I told stories in my memoir, Momenta Blues, it was to guide the reader through the corridors of my life. When I sometimes tell stories from my drum set on The Tonight Show, it's to get a laugh out of Jimmy or to lead into the next segment. In this book, the stories are commentaries on themselves. Opportunities to present and analyze the creative process. Think of them as a remix. Do creative people just make things without thinking about them? Do they worry about not getting it right? Or being told that they're not getting it right? Or do they just walk into the room, take the paint and canvas, and go to work? I'm asking because I've never been able to set aside that self-consciousness. Because of that, I have long been interested in books about creativity. Or rather, I've been interested by why I'm skeptical of them. I buy them and read them, and then think about whether or not they contribute to my overall sense of things. Specifically, how ideas move from my brain out into the world. More often than not, they don't. It's not a criticism of the books, necessarily. Many of them are books that other people swear by. They tell me to get them and assure me that they'll change my life. When they don't, I'm always a little bit deflated. What I've learned is my approach to creativity is unlike most other people's. I don't know if it's better or worse, but I know that it's different, largely because my experience has pulled me through all these disparate disciplines, sometimes without much advanced preparation. Books about creativity, at least before this one, tend to fall into two broad categories. On one hand, there are books that treat creativity from a straightforward how-to stance. How do you make a best-selling record? How do you write a blockbuster screenplay? How can any average citizen tap into their creative instincts? On the other hand, there are books that look at creativity as a therapeutic endeavor. How do you come up with ideas that make you a better and more confident person in your everyday life? I wanted to write a book that does both at the same time. I have worked as a creative professional since I was in my teens, and I feel compelled by each of these capacities, creative and professional. art doesn't have to be something you do only behind closed doors for personal spiritual gain. But it also isn't simply a product-based process that's at the mercy of the market. I live and work at the intersection of art and commerce. I want to show people how I learned to move along two tracks at once, how I kept taking personal risk in my art while at the same time negotiating the ins and outs of commercial success. The result is this book, which is my story of understanding creativity and succeeding in creative endeavors. I want to use my experiences, not only my own success and failures, but the challenges faced by and overcome by others, to help readers and listeners plot a course through the creative process. Everyone knows the broad shape of that process. Everyone knows that it starts with the idea and ends with the execution of that idea. But the quest of the artist is both more general and more specific. You have to know when to leap on an idea and when to leave it alone, when to keep it close to the vest and when to release it into the world, when to consolidate your gains and when to move into uncharted territory. Creativity isn't Candyland. It's more complicated than that. But there is a game board and general principles to follow, and I want to sketch it out for readers and listeners. In The Wizard of Oz, after Dorothy has been through the ringer, the Good Witch tells her that she has had the power to go home all along. All she had to do was click the heels of her ruby slippers. Now, I'm not going to Good Witch you guys and make you wait till the end. I'm going to tell you right at the beginning. You, and only you, have the power to make these creative exercises work. All I can do is drop hints, drop breadcrumbs, drop science. Pick up what you want, when you want. This book, or audiobook, is in your hands. How it gets used is also in your hands. I won't make grand claims, but I will make this one. If you use this audiobook properly, you'll learn something. Even if what you learn is that you already believed in your own versions of many of these insights. That's one of the secrets that maybe a savvier marketer would say for a bonus track, but I'm sequencing first. Lots of these things will harmonize with the instincts you already have. I'll give you supporting evidence. I'll show you how other people have made similar practices, both to each other and to me. Most important, I'll encourage you to recognize that your own suspicions about creativity are probably correct. Getting to the point where you can credit your own intuition is an important part of moving forward creatively. I often think of creativity as functioning in the middle of a stream. Ideas are happening all around me, all the time, and I had to learn how to process them all. I've learned how to be a filter, inform, active, engage, and motivate it. Whether I'm working on an album, a song, a design, or a conversation, I've been lucky enough to cross paths with thought leaders in various fields, from Neil deGrasse Tyson, to President Barack Obama, to Tom Sachs, to Bjork, to Farin Adria, to David Lynch, to Kiende Wiley, to Wingete Mutu, to Usher. These people have inspired me often with stories about how others inspired them. Each creative person sits at the base of a tree whose branches stretch far and wide, to other fields, back through time, in ways that help define and redefine their creative process. What follows is a bit of a leap, but creativity always is. So let's interlock arms, metaphorically speaking, and jump. The spark. The record collection. When I was a kid, my dad had the record collection. I guess it was technically a record collection, but to me, it was the collection. He had so many records of so many different kinds. He had soul music, of course, because he had been a doo-wop singer and a leader of a popular group in the mid-50s, and soul. At least the smooth soul of the mid-70s, before disco came along, was the most direct descendant of doo-wop. What we've come to call yacht rock or soft rock with vocal harmonies like Kenny Loggins or Christopher Cross was his favorite genre. because it sort of had the same vibe as doo-wop. But he also had arena rock and jazz and classic soul and funk and reggae. A little of everything. The thing about records was they didn't feel like closed ideas. They were ideas you can open and ideas you could use. And that's what my dad did. He played those records in the house. The memories are so vivid for me. I was at home in Philly. I was 3, usually after dinner and before bedtime. We had a 2-hour window where my mom and dad would relax and listen to music. They would stack up 6 records over the turntable on the changer and let them play through. That meant I got all the side ones of all the LPs. One night, the first record in the stack was Stevie Wonder Presents Sarita, the second album by Sarita Wright, the talented singer-songwriter and vocalist who was Stevie's ex-wife. The second song on that particular record was Spinnin' and Spinnin', which puts forward the theory that a love affair can be like a merry-go-round, exciting but also dizzying. The middle of the song had a circus feel, almost music hall, and it accelerates and accelerates. Right as it ended, I heard a large clap in the kitchen. I looked over and saw a mouse in the trap, neck caught, still alive, and squealing. To this day, rodents remain a major trauma. That memory anchors the song emotionally, but I also remember thinking about it analytically, obsessing over all the other elements of the record. In particular, I became preoccupied with the final synthesizer wash that was playing right when the mouse's neck went into the trap. In retrospect, I can clearly see that Stevie and Sarita had overdosed on the Beatles, and particularly on Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. Sarita had covered She's Leaving Home on her first record 2 years before. Using the Beatles and white British pop as a touchstone gave Stevie freedom. As a black artist, he wasn't confined to funk workouts or Four on the Floor. It led him to some of his greatest music, which happens to be some of the greatest music that anyone's ever made. At the time, though, I was 3. I hadn't separated my reactions into emotion on one hand and analysis on the other. I got all of it in one waterfall. That final synthesizer sound is the death knell for the mouse, and it's frightening. The feeling has never left me. I started to think that way about every record in the house. It didn't matter if it was Al Green singing Call Me or Pilot singing Magic. They all meant more than they were. They captured a time in the sense that they were a record or a recording session. And then they captured another time in the sense that I remember vividly where I was when I first heard them. That has lasted through my whole life. My first car accident was to the tune of Alanis Morissette's Ironic. I skidded on ice while I was on a date with a Rutgers girl. I was driving carefully by a pileup of 5 cars, rubbernecking a bit, and we spun right into it. That song is forever a car accident song. Spinning and spinning. Those records were some of my most important introductions to idea making and how it becomes creative product. I heard music from other sources. I heard it from the radio. I heard it from my parents' band when they went on stage to play. I heard it from myself when I was practicing the drums. But records were a full package. They were music on the air, but they were also the black disc spinning around with the label in the middle. They were also the cover photo. They were also the liner notes. They were something in my hands, physical weight, something that could block out sunlight. They did everything they could with the idea, and it was something. After a lifetime of making records, I now stand in the shade of the tree of the entire process, of the entire product. But I think I had the seed of things even then. We've come a long way since then. And in some sense, we've gone backwards. Records don't have big covers anymore. They don't have liner notes in the same way. They don't have labels at the center. And most of the music we consume is not in physical form. It's in a cloud. And then it gets sent to our pocket without ever being a thing that we can put our hands on. But you can put your head in it. Songs are still ideas. When I hear them, I still think back to those moments when I held the cover in my hands and thought about the brain that brought it out of nothingness into existence. I didn't understand that process back then, and I'm not sure I understand it now. Tore up. Talking about creativity tends to take place in metaphors. For starters, it's hard to hit the thing head on. I've read lots of books about the creative process over the years, and their first job is usually to figure out what makes for a creative person.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.